Duty Bound, Agents of the Crown, Book 3. Written by Lindsay Buroker. Narrated by Vivienne Leheny. Chapter 1. Somewhere outside the dark cave, pots clanked and the wind moaned. Harsh, guttural voices spoke, rising and falling in a discussion. Zenia couldn't understand them. Were they even human? Fear flowed through her veins. Where was she? She lifted her head, and chains rattled. For some reason, she lay on her belly, looking toward the misty gray sky outside the mouth of the cave. She tried to rise, but the chains held her down. The shackles bound her limbs and ran across her back, pinning her to the rough earthen floor. Her fear grew stronger as she realized how little she could move. Again, she tried to rise, muscles bunching and flexing in her haunches. Haunches? Strange. Her body did not seem to be her own. A grunt came from the cave entrance, and a large, muscled figure stepped into view. Straight white hair hanging to its inhuman shoulders. She couldn't see the face, but the hint of a tusk protruded from its silhouette. An orc? Zenia had heard stories of orcs, trolls, ogres, and how they hated humans, elves, and dwarves, and had once battled great wars with them. But those races never came to the capital anymore. They had not been welcome for many generations, with people hunting them until they fled the continents that men claimed, and sightings were rare throughout the kingdom. Wherever Zenia was, she doubted she was in the kingdom anymore. The orc lifted a sword and pointed the sharp tip at her. It spoke in the guttural language. She heard herself growl, the deep growl of a dangerous predator. But the orc wasn't afraid of her. It strode in, lifting the sword as it... A knock sounded at the door. Zenia bolted upright in bed, her fingers clenched in a blanket that fell to her waist. She peered around the dim room, struggling to get her bearings. The shadowy figure of the orc remained all too prominent in her mind, and she expected to see it crouching behind the armoire, poised to drive that sword through her heart. The knock came again, and she managed to push the memory, the dream, away, rational thought overriding the fear that lingered. She was in her room at Alderoth Castle, where she worked as captain of His Majesty's Crown Agents. There weren't any orcs within hundreds of miles. Dim light filtered through the window and signaled dawn's approach. Who was knocking on her door so early? Jev? Excitement stirred in her breast at the possibility, and she hurried to grab her robe and don it. She hadn't spoken to Jev in 2 days, not since she'd pulled away from his kiss and told him they couldn't date, not when there was no possibility of marriage between her, a common woman, and him, Zinder and heir to his family's estate. She hadn't been deliberately avoiding him, even though part of her was tempted, since she didn't know what to say to him now. But he hadn't been around the castle much. She'd had to hear from Zinder Garlock in the office that Jev's friend Cutter and the dwarven gem cutter Master Arcura Grindmore were missing. First, her magical diamond-encrusted carving tools had disappeared, and now the dwarf herself. As Zenia opened the door, she wondered what she would say if it was Jev. What if he wanted to convince her that she'd been wrong, that they should date and enjoy each other's company, even if marriage wasn't a possibility? But it wasn't Jev. "Oh," Zenia said. Ri Lin, former monk of the Water Order and current rookie crown agent, stood in the hallway. She gripped her 6-foot-long bow staff in one hand and held a pack over her shoulder with the other. "Oh," Ri asked. "I realize it's early, but you needn't sound disappointed to see me. Unless I'm interrupting something." Ri cocked an eyebrow and peered around Zenia and toward the bed. "Your sheets are certainly rumpled enough to suggest vigorous lovemaking was going on last night. But I don't see a naked Zinder, unfortunately. No, I had a dream. A dream or a nightmare? The sheets were a tangled mess, and her blanket had fallen to the sheepskin rug beside the bed. I'm not sure. Zenia rubbed her face. Memories of being chained and of the hulking sword-wielding orc returning to her mind. It doesn't matter. Your arrival here must mean it's time to get up. Thank the founders. She didn't want to go back to sleep and risk the dream returning. Wherever it had been heading, she knew she wouldn't have liked it. Though, you're earlier than necessary, Rhi. Are you trying to earn the approval of the king and your fellow agents by being extremely punctual? Actually, I'm looking for some place to throw my stuff until I can find a room to let. Archmage Sashin kicked me out of the temple almost as quickly as she kicked you out. I told her I'd gotten a job up here and tried to give her a week's notice, and she fired me on the spot. I'm sorry, Zenia said, guilt welling in her chest. That's because of me. I'm a delightful person who's going to let me stash my belongings here for the day. And perhaps recommend to the king that his newest and sexiest agent would love a room down the hall from yours here at the castle. Sexiest? Rhi no longer wore her monk's gi from the Water Order Temple, but she had chosen a crisp long-sleeved shirt and trousers that snapped in a similar manner when she punched and kicked people. The new outfit didn't show off any more skin than the gi had. Sexiest, Rhi said firmly. I've seen the bulbous blowhards at work in your office. The competition is scant. I work there. Yes, and you're quite pretty, and you have those perky bosoms, but the more rugged sex finds you distant and unapproachable. Also, you walk like a man. To be sexy, you need to sway your hips in a way that rivets men's eyes to your backside as you walk away. Zenia didn't think she was as unapproachable as she had been when she'd worked as an inquisitor for the Water Order, but admitted she wasn't the best judge. Had she ever truly been distant? She was inclined to deny that, but then thought of the way she'd pushed Jev away, not willing to let him get close out of the fear that their kisses might turn into something she'd long ago vowed to avoid, as long as she was an unmarried woman. Go ahead and put your stuff down, Zenia said, having the urge to change the subject. She waved for Rhi to set her pack inside the door. As for the rest, I don't think it's within my power to get you a room here. None of the other agents stay in the castle, and I barely know King Targian, so I would feel awkward asking him for a favor. Zinder Darrow stays here. Yes, but Jev is the king's army buddy. The rest of the agents stay in town with their wives or girlfriends. Alas, I don't have one of those to impose upon. Zenia smiled faintly. She was glad Rhi was coming to work in the office, especially since the only other female agent had turned out to be instrumental in the deaths of King Abdor's sons. The day before, Lunas Drem had sailed away from the harbor on a ship bound for another kingdom. Though horrified at what the former agent had done, Zenia was glad she had been exiled instead of executed. "Did you know your chest is glowing?" Rhi asked. Zenia looked down. The dragon tear that King Targian had given her to use while in his employ lay under both her nightshirt and robe, but a faint blue glow was indeed seeping out. She glanced at the bed again, wondering if the dream could have anything to do with the gem. Her old dragon tear had never prompted odd dreams, but in the few days she'd had this one, she'd quickly come to realize it was different from the norm, more powerful, and she wasn't sure exactly. The dragon tear almost came across as sentient. A faint vibration emanated from the gem. Yes, Zenia said. It does that sometimes. Do people find it alarming? Rhi spoke in her usual joking tone, but her brown eyes held a hint of concern. Had Cutter told Ree what he'd told Zenia and Jev? That the gem, its oval surface intricately carved with the likeness of a dragon instead of a typical dagger or quill, might take on some aspects of the creature?
Only if they're looking at my... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.